Victorian era medicine was in a world of transition, from one of chance and superstition to one of hospitals and modern science. Despite this revolution, the 19th century was still a time when the working classes didn't have regular access to healthcare, so street doctors stepped in to fill the gap and fill their pockets. Some were no more than quacks and exploited the poor and needy with dishonest cures and worthless potions, so that those already suffering grinding poverty and poor sanitation were tricked out of money with false hopes. You're going to hear the story of Victorian London street doctors, as told in an account from Street Life in London, 1877, by John Thomson and Adolphe Smith, and is narrated in the words of Smith. Thomson was a talented and influential photographer who joined with Smith, a journalist, in a project to photograph the street life of London's poor. The authors were careful not to varnish their words for an audience. What they saw and heard accurately reflects their interactions with everyday people and genuinely immerses the reader in authentic Victorian street life. You can check the in-video cards and description for links to more interesting videos about the Victorians. In particular, we have Street Life in London, from the same authors, which opens a window on more genuinely wonderful characters from Victorian London and the hard lives they led. Do check it out. Before we start, please consider clicking the subscribe button in the bottom right of your screen for more content like this. If you find this video interesting, I would really appreciate it if you could give it a thumbs up and share it widely with friends and family. These two things really do show your support and help the channel grow so I can bring you more. Thank you. The subject of the accompanying illustration is a vendor of cough lozenges and healing ointment. He was originally a car driver, employed by a firm in the city, but had to leave his situation on account of failing sight. His story, told in his own words, is as follows.
First of all, I had to leave my place on account of bad sight. It was brought on by exposure to the cold. Inflammation set in the right eye and soon affected the left. The doctors called it atrophy. I went to St. Thomas's Hospital for 9 months, to St. George's Hospital, and to Moorfields Ophthalmic Hospital. From St. Thomas's Hospital, I was sent to the seaside at the expense of the Merchant Tailors Company. No good came of it at all, and at last I was so blind that I had to be led about like a child. At that time, my wife worked with her needle and her hands to keep things going. She used to do charring during the day and sewing at night. Shirt making for the friend of a woman who worked for a contractor. She got twopence halfpenny for making a shirt, and by sitting till 2 or 3 in the morning could finish 3 shirts at a stretch. I stood at a street corner in the new cut selling fish, and had to trust a good deal to the honesty of my customers, as I could not see. At this time, I fell in with a gentleman selling ointment. He gave me a box, which I used for my eyes. I used the ointment about a month and found my sight gradually returning. The gentleman who makes the ointment offered to set me up in business with his goods. I had no money, but he gave me everything on trust. It was a good thing for both of us, because I was a sort of, I don't know, standing advertisement for him and for myself. I now make a comfortable living and have a good stock. When the maker of the ointment started, he carried a tray. Now he has 3 vans and more than 50 people selling for him. I find most of my customers in the street, but I'm now making a private connection at home of people from all parts of London. The price of the Arabian family ointment, which can be used for chapped hands, lips, inflamed eyes, cuts, scalds and sores, are from a penny to a 0.5 crown a box. Medicated cough lozenges, 0.5 and 1 a packet.
Street vendors of pills, potions and quack nostrums are not quite so numerous as they were in former days. The increasingly large number of free hospitals, where the poor may consult qualified physicians, the aid received at a trifling cost from clubs and friendly societies, and the spread of education have all tended to sweep this class of street folks from the thoroughfares of London. Although of late years, much has been done by private charities to supplement the system of parochial relief, there is still a vast field open for the extension of medical missions among the lower orders of the community. Far from being in a position to record the extinction of the race of herbalists and doctors for the million who practice upon the poor, my investigations prove they are still about as numerous as their trade is lucrative. It would be unjust to say that the itinerant empirics of the metropolis have advanced with the age, as it is part of their role to adhere to all that is old in the nomenclature and practice of their craft. An intelligent member of the fraternity informed me that as members of the medical profession, they are bound to use what may be called crocus Latin. Our profession is known, sir, as crocusing, and our dodges and decoctions as fakes or rackets. Many other words make up a sort of dead language that protects us and the public from ignorant impostors. It don't do to juggle with drugs, leastwise to them that are ignorant of the business. I was told by a chum of mine, a university man, that crocusing is nigh as old as Adam, and that some of our best rackets were copied from Egyptian tombs. I venture to remark possibly they were inscribed on the tombs as a warning from the dead. Like as not, was the rejoinder. I expect the dead in this country could tell us somewhat about poisoning by Act of Parliament. Pardon me, sir. You may be a licensed surgeon yourself, but I would as soon swallow a brass knocker as some of your drugs. A brass knocker is a safe prescription for opening a door. It's poison as a pill. I believe it is just the same with the poisons tuck out of the bowels of the earth, where they should be left to correct disorders. Herbs are the thing. They were intended for man, and they grow at his feet for meat and medicine. You see, sir, I'm a bit of a philosopher. When I'm not pattering, speaking, I'm thinking. I have been a cough tablet croakers for 9 years. Only in summer I go for the sarsaparilla fake. Sometimes this is a regular take-down swindle. The blood purifier is made up of a cheap herb called sassafras, burnt sugar, and water flavoured with a little pineapple or pear juice. That's what's called sarsaparilla by some crocuses. If it don't lengthen the life of the buyer, it lengthens the life of the seller. It's about the same thing in the end. A very shady racket is the India root for destroying all sorts of vermin, including rats. It's put among clothes like camphor. Any root will answer if it's scented. But this racket requires sailor's togs, for the crocus must have just come off the ship from foreign parts. Yet also requires a couple of tame rats to fight shy of the root. The silver paste is a fatal fake. The paste is made of whiting and red ochre. The crocus has a solution of bichloride of mercury, which he mixes with the paste, and rubbing it over a farthing silvers it. He sells it for plating brass candlesticks and such like. But it's the mercury that does the business. He don't sell that. The mercury in time gets into his blood,
and finishes them. I've known two kill this way.
There are many different dodges in crocusing. One man I know, togged like a military swell, scares the people into buying his pills. He has half a dozen bottles filled with different fluids he works with, turning one into t'other. He turns a clear fluid black and says,
"Ladies and gentlemen, this is what happens to your blood when exposed to the fogs of London. Without blood, there is no life. You seem bloodless, my friends. Look at each other."
They look and almost believe him.
"Next to no blood is impure blood. This is your condition. I can describe your symptoms. I offer you the only safe, certain, and infallible remedy."
This style of patter makes the pills fly, but it's not everyone can come it to perfection. As to myself, my patter is on the scholarly tact, reason and persuasion. I uphold the medical profession for most things and tell all I know, and more so about materia medica, for I don't know much. Once a learned cove, a student, I think, tried to take a rise out of me. Says he, "What's materia medica?" Says I, "If you've descended from Balaam's arse, you've browsed on it in the fields." I never saw him again. I'm not going to give you my patter. I can't turn it on like steam. You should hear me at my best. It's well worth publishing. On a fair night, in a good pitch, with a crowd round me, my tongue seems aflame. Some of our best patterers lush heavily. One used to say, "Demosthenes, when he studied oratory, went to the seashore and filled his mouth with pebbles. I know a trick worth two of that. I'll go to the nearest public and fill my mouth with a glass of the best Scotch whiskey." He went there once too often. The fact is, most of us come to the gutter through boozing. And if a racket is dishonest, you may be certain the crocus drinks hard. The corn fake pays with a fellow who can patter. His stock costs next to nothing. It should be sulphur and rosin to drop on the corn red hot. But rosin does alone at a pinch. I find a good honest racket pays best in the end. People buy and come again. I've my regular customers for years, and now I make a tidy living both summer and winter. And I need all I earn, for I've my old mother depending on me.
My informant has the reputation of being an honest, hard-working fellow. His cough tablets, if they do not possess all the virtues he ascribes to them, are certainly pleasant to the taste. On the occasion of my last visit to my informant, I had an opportunity of seeing one or two of his patients. One, a blacksmith, who had burned his arm severely, stoutly testified to the wonderful healing properties of the ointment. Another, also a worker in iron, came in to purchase a box.
"It has been the saving of my wife," he said. "She's a bad leg, but this salve keeps the wound open, and this wound do act as a safety valve to her heart. Were it allowed to close, she would die of heart disease. Me and me wife discover this, and it's worth knowing. It draws off the bad humour, and bless you, sir, there's a deal of bad humour about my wife. I'm a temperance son of the phoenix. My wife ain't. She would not be a phoenix if she could. She pulls one way, I pull t'other. She was a teetotal for 5 years before me. But when I became a phoenix, she took to the bottle. So she did. The phoenix is our benefit and burial society. I pay 3 pence a week into it and would be decently buried if I died. It is in the interest of the phoenixes to get us to live long, and for that reason it is a teetotal brotherhood."
This man was subscribing tuppence halfpenny weekly to a club which secured for him and his family the attendance of a surgeon in the neighbourhood. For all that, he had sought the aid of this dispenser of quack compounds, and expressed himself perfectly satisfied with the result of his treatment.
I found in the course of my inquiries that the poor, many of them, prefer either resorting to quack remedies or employing their own paid surgeon, to placing themselves in the hands of the parish doctor or under hospital treatment. This is accounted for in two ways. An honorable feeling of independence deters the poorer orders of the laboring classes from seeking parish relief in any shape. Others, who would gladly avail themselves of free medical advice, cannot find time to obtain a certificate from the relieving officer and to present this certificate in the proper quarter. And when all the forms have been duly complied with, grievous delays frequently occur in obtaining advice and the necessary prescriptions. The latter have, in some instances, to be taken to the dispensary at the other end of the parish. Some of the aged, infirm, and friendless poor who receive regular outdoor relief have under ordinary circumstances to pay a messenger a shilling for collecting their weekly pittance of half a crown. In time of sickness, when they cannot crawl from their door, they too are fain to avail themselves of the remedies of itinerant doctors.